Hold on. Hey, everybody, look who is here with me today. I am so happy to welcome to my channel the illustrious and amazing Richard Barbieri.
Thank you.
Originally of Japan, these days Porcupine Tree. Richard, thanks so much for taking some time to join me and folks on the channel. How are you doing?
Okay, thanks, Derek. Yeah, nice to meet you. Yeah, just as I said before we started recording, apologies for any sneezes or sounds coming from me. I've got quite a heavy cold. It's come on very, very quickly.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Yeah. But I'm fine. I'm fine apart from that.
Thank you so much for joining me. Richard, to start off with, congratulations on this and on the tour. How was the tour for you?
It was great. It was so enjoyable. I think we did everything right. We kind of corrected all the things in the past that towards the end of our kind of first career, if you like, on the incident tour, the things that were wrong about that, we kind of got right this time and just made it a really enjoyable tour. Not too long. So every concert was kind of vital. We didn't get complacent. And we had a lot of time apart from each other, which was good as well.
Yes, indeed.
Separate dressing rooms, separate buses. And then we came together for on like days off for a meal or when we go on stage, obviously, or to have conversations. And that was nice because, before we were kind of on top of each other all the time, 12 hours a day, every day. And that can lead to kind of frustrations and problems.
Absolutely.
So we did it the right way and it was really, really enjoyable. And the reaction from the supporters was amazing.
It's wonderful. I'm so glad to see it. Obvious question, will there be a documentation of it presented, DVD, live recording, anything?
Yeah, we recorded the show live in Amsterdam at the Ziggo Dome, which was the biggest gig we played in Europe.
Nice.
So it's just close to 14,000 people there. And there's a little bit kind of documentary footage around that day as well. And we're going to be
Cool.
doing some interviews as well,
Awesome,
So
awesome,
I think
awesome.
it'll be a nice, thing that we hope will get on TV worldwide.
Nice. Richard, I'm glad that I get a chance to share with you that the reason that I even listened to Porcupine Tree is because of you and Steve Jansen. And I discovered them through following your trajectory. I've noticed you guys were guests on a No Man record. That's when I first heard of Steve Wilson and followed that. But I honestly considered you, Richard, a pioneer in synthesizers and in the sounds. It's like you have, to me, changed the game with how you've created one note with such texture and entire worlds. How did that happen, Richard?
Well, it kind of had to happen, really, because I didn't have any technique to speak of to play conventional keyboards. And it was only when I kind of gave up worrying about the keys and focused more on the controls and I started to create sound that I actually felt I could sort of contribute something. And
Absolutely.
so then I started make my quite simplistic style. I started making one note do more. Rather than play 100 notes without any real kind of purpose or sound or atmosphere.
You do it well. To my ears, this album is when things really start to come into focus. It's like on Quiet Life, it sounded like you guys were kind of doing a Marauder, Giorgio Moroder thing. And then by the time this comes out, it's your sound. And am I correct in thinking that a big part of that was you, Richard? It really seems like a big part of this unique sound is your contribution.
Yeah, I think you're just an album too late in my opinion. I think Quiet Life, for me, Quiet Life was the one where I found my voice and it was very sequencer driven and it was also an album where we got time to work on arrangements and had the luxury of going and making overdubs.
Okay.
Like I'd play something and then I'd say, and now I want to try this on top, and now I want to do this.
Okay.
And we were in a great studio. There's lots of kind of flavors to that album. There's orchestrations. It's just a very, what's the word? Sophisticated recording.
Well, I'll listen to it with fresh
ears.
Yeah, well, I'll listen to it with fresh ears now because I do have it and I do like it. This is, the, like I said, Gentleman is the one where it's like, that was one where I found myself playing it on repeat.
Okay.
Really getting into it.
Yeah, I think that kind of consolidated what we did with Quiet Life in a way. Mm-hmm. We just took it a little bit further with Polaroids.
Mm-hmm.
But the most enjoyable album for me to make, and probably my favorite Japan album, is Quiet Life.
Wow.
Although probably the best work is Tin Drum.
Oh my God, this is classic, amazing work, Richard. And again, it sounds like you kind of were one of the central ball carriers. You know, that whole timbre of the East that the keyboards conjures up. It's very, very, very powerful.
Well, I think David Sylvian needs a lot of credit as well. I think we shared duties, really, keyboard duties throughout the album. There was no guitar really to speak of.
Mm-hmm.
And there were a lot of, you know, long sessions programming, trying to get that right sound, that right flavor, and all the time respecting the space and trying to keep things minimal.
Yeah.
And that's kind of, if there is a beauty to that album, because it's sometimes not a beautiful sound, but it's the use of space that I think works so well.
It's very compelling. The other thing I'd like to share, Richard, is it seems like you kind of grew up in public. When I first heard you back in the 70s, the first record I heard was a single, Sometimes I Feel So Low. And it's like it's almost like it's a different band.
Yeah.
Was that your experience, that through music you're kind of growing from being a boy into a man in a way?
Yeah, kind of. I think we were all looking for something, you know, trying to find our own voices, and some people found it earlier, some were better suited to being in the studio environment. You know, we were very influenced at the time for that album by American punk.
Hmm.
We never really got off on the UK punk scene.
Okay.
We gravitated towards the American scene because there was a kind of art, an artiness to it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there was like kind of thought behind things, and there were clever things going on. So we like bands like Television.
Yes.
Talking Heads.
Absolutely, yeah.
Even Richard Hell was.
Yeah,
Had more things going for it, I felt. And like, obviously, Iggy Pop and Lou Reed from the past.
Yeah.
They were all kind of punk, but it was sophisticated punk. It was punk with poetry and things. Patti Smith, you know.
Mm-hmm. Love Patti Smith. Yeah.
And I think we tried to get that kind of vibe into those recordings, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, the mm-hmm. quite harsh guitars and the kind of quite brutal sort of sound and new wave almost sound. Yeah.
Well, the sophistication definitely grew in your music. Did you ever have an opportunity to play shows with any of those bands?
What, the bands I was talking about?
Yeah.
No, we got to, in the beginning, we got to support a lot of bands, obviously, mm-hmm. as you do. So our first major support was supporting Blue Oyster Cult.
Whoa. That's kind of different.
And they were doing like a kind of theatre tour around the UK. And mm-hmm. Their fans absolutely hated us.
I'm sure.
And they booed at us and everything. It was just, they couldn't wait for us to leave the stage.
Oh, man. But
we actually picked up really good reviews.
Mm-hmm.
So while a lot of the newspapers were kind of saying, you know, Blue Oyster Cult were these has-beens and, you know, kind of, and they kind of got off on what we were doing in a way.
Yeah. So, maybe inspired them a little bit, perhaps.
Yeah. I mean, we supported some funny bands. We supported The Damned.
Oh, I love The Damned.
Yeah.
I love them.
We supported Ossibisa.
Say it again?
We supported Ossibisa.
Oh wow. Yeah. Now that's quite a contrast. And again, another band that I quite like. So do bands like Duran Duran ever acknowledge your influence on them? Do you
Yeah, they
know?
do. Yeah, to their credit, they do. In fact, they did a couple of weeks ago when they were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Nice.
They gave
Yeah.
Japan a mention and the crowd applauded, so that's quite
Oh,
nice.
wonderful,
Yeah,
wonderful.
they're nice guys, and they've always talked about, us as an influence.
That's wonderful. Richard, I'm all over the place in my head, so I'm going to try to get
That's
focused here
fine.
because your music really is very important to me. Dolphin Brothers. I think, again, did this do anything anywhere? I think this is wonderful. And in particular, the single Face to Face that never came out in the US, I picked up the Japanese so I could have it.
Okay.
Did that happen? Did this happen anywhere?
No, not really. It kind of started to, and then for some reason the company, which was Virgin, kind of pulled the plug on it, and we're never really 100% sure why. It's one of those things that go on behind the scenes. You don't know what's happening, what decisions are being made, but they were certainly keen for it while we were recording it and when we'd finished it. But no, it just didn't, for some reason, one reason or another, it didn't take off.
It seemed like you guys were ready to take on the whole pop business after Japan again. And I'm curious for you, Richard, because I get so much musicality out of you, and yet at the same time, it's like there's been this flirting with pop stardom. What's your take on that?
Well, we had pop stardom in the beginning, for sure, with Japan. It's not anything that we sought or that we reveled in. It was more a hindrance than anything else, but it was definitely, we were pop stars. We would be in the daily newspapers, we would be on the television, and once you're in the BBC archives and you're kind of part of that scene. The people would sleep outside our house, we'd get hassled non-stop.
That's wild.
It's that kind of thing.
That's wild.
And I think we all tried very hard to escape that. I kind of, that's why I always feel a bit weird about the Dolphin Brothers thing, because I think that was our attempt at pop music. But I don't think it worked.
Very good songs, though. Great sounds.
There's a couple of tracks I think are I still like, but I think it's very much of its time.
My
And
Winter, My Winter.
My Winter is one of those. Yeah, it's a great
Oh,
track.
come on, brother. That is a kill. That is a beautiful song.
It is. My Winter and the title track, I think, are two great tracks, but
Yes, they're wonderful. Now, speaking
they
of all
are.
that stuff now, you and Steve made some of the best music I have ever heard in my life. I'm telling you, Richard, that's why I'm so honored to be talking to you. This is one of the best albums in my collection. Now, people talk about Talk Talk. This is the shit. How did you come up with this, man? How'd you come up with this?
I don't know. We just worked together in our little studio that we built. I think that was on a 16-track reel to reel.
Wow.
Yeah, I
I
don't know. I don't.
swim there, swim there. It's just amazing. How does a track like that get started? How did that evolve? I think seriously, it's incredible music.
Well, that track was. It's Steve Jansen, and his kind of his way of composition and working with different time signatures and patterns, and he's very, very much into that. He has a very kind of cerebral approach to music. And I mean, I have to say, the most enjoyment I've got out of those albums is watching you listen to
That's
them.
wild because this is some
Kind
of the
of, I'm
best.
noticing things that I hadn't, because you're pointing out little things that are going on, and
Oh
that was
man, this stuff
enjoyable.
is just awesome. I'm so touched by the connection that we have across the years and time through the internet. I'll tell you again before I go on about you. I was so blown away, Richard, when you bought some of my tracks a few years ago. Thank you. Wow. You know what I mean?
No, not at all. No, I, you know, when I can get time, I love to listen to all kinds of stuff and to support as many people as I can.
Greatly appreciated. Now, I'll tell you what. Here's another one. Are these ever possibly coming out on vinyl or not?
Yeah, it's nowadays, as you probably know, it's not easy to make vinyl.
Not at all.
You're looking at planning 8 or 9 months ahead. I mean, even with the Porcupine Tree album, we had to wait 9 months. Mm-hmm. We had the whole album finished. But so there are massive queues already, and we're at the back of the queue, you know.
Wow.
And then you have to start looking at, well, there's co-writes here. There's this track was from, belonged to this label. Or there, you know, there's mm-hmm. administrative complications yeah. along the way as well.
Wow. Well, I'm glad I have it because it's just some of the best music. And just to keep it moving here, one of the things I hate about being older is how often I have to go to the damn bathroom, okay? And that interrupts me, you know? So excuse me, I may have to make a run here in a second. But Richard, when this came out, Under a Spell, it's like you are carving an entire musical world of your own. It's like it's not really comparable to anyone, and it's not rock or jazz or ambient, and yet there's all those elements. Mm. I find this work brilliant, Richard. Really, I really do.
Thank you.
And this stuff, all of the stuff, the variants. I was just playing this last night. Plus the artwork. The artwork is just so evocative. Now, it's interesting. You can create pieces of great beauty. Then you'll have these other mysterious kind of dark pieces too. And it's like more than being visual, it conjures up to me states of mind.
Mm. I think so.
How do you approach making this music? And that's a broad question, but it's like I'm fascinated.
Well, with that album, it kind of was the merging of dreams, lucid dreams, in fact. But combined with the very surreal atmosphere outside, because we were in COVID shutdown.
Yeah.
And this was the first shutdown.
Yeah.
So it was like all those science fiction films you see. Mm-hmm. Where it's deserted. And a couple of people walk by with a mask and they walk right on the other side of the road to avoid each other. And it was very weird. And I went for a lot of long walks mm-hmm. because I wanted to maximize my time outside and get some exercise. And so I walked through a lot of kind of the woods around here. And it was just a very eerie kind of feeling.
Okay.
And it's like that feeling came into my dreams and it all merged to create this kind of inner world.
Very, very effectively. And seemingly a further move on from this, Planets and Persona.
Yes, well, Under a Spell is much more introspective. I mean, the idea was to make Planets and Persona an extension of that previous album. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Planets and Persona is a very expansive album. You know, mm-hmm. it was made in a lot of different locations. Mm-hmm. It was made in old school way, you know, in studios working with musicians.
Yes, yes.
There's a lot of different performances on there, a lot of different flavors. And that was really enjoyable. And that's what I wanted to do for the follow-up. But of course, there was lockdown and everything became closed in on you. And
right.
So it just became me and my studio here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Planets and Persona, it's almost jazzy in parts.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm the one who's supposed to hate jazz as well.
Well, and that's bold.
Somebody.
Which is baloney because now I don't really hear influences in your work except one, I forget the track it is, but it says, I'll be damned if that don't sound like Joe Zawinul.
I love Joe Zawinul.
Yeah, he's a bad. He's badass. He's badass. So is there plans for more solo recording?
I don't know. The thing is, I don't have a career, so I never look on music as a career. So I never think there are deadlines or that I should be doing this or I should be doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I've been fortunate in that I'm able to record when I feel I've got something to say. And that's what was so amazing about the Porcupine Tree album was that for the first time in our lives, nobody knew we were making it and we had no deadlines.
Yeah.
And when you have no deadlines and nobody knows you're making this album, you can throw the music away. And once you know you can throw it away, it frees you up.
Yeah.
To do what you really want to do. So I don't kind of think ahead in terms of I've got to keep my profile up. I've got to do this. I've got to do that. I mean, I hate the industry. I hate the whole music business.
No doubt. Understood. Understood.
Any time I can spend away from it is great. Certainly you have to do certain things, I realize, but so I have no plans. I mean, I'm sure there will be another solo album. I'm sure there'll be other collaborative albums.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful, Richard.
When I kind of feel like it should happen.
Man, that's nice. That's the way to be rather than all that pressure. That's beautiful. So you're enjoying the break from the tour. You guys are going back out, I understand.
We're going to be doing, I think, about 9 or 10 festival shows. A lot of them will be our own shows, but outdoor. It's just a kind of nice thing to do, just to get together again, reconvene, and just do some nice shows in the summer.
Yeah.
And then I think that will come the point where things will shut down and Stephen will go into solo mode. And I'm sure Gavin will have lots of things to do.
Yeah.
And then we'll see. We'll see what the future holds.
Cool.
We don't mind if it's closure. We don't mind if it's continuation.
And that's wonderful. What a nice place to be. Yeah. Huh? You're in control. You know, I almost met you. I've seen Porcupine Tree 4 times now. And
when?
I saw you in Seattle, Kansas City, Minneapolis, and I almost met you in Portland. I think it was on the Dead Wing tour. I was behind the club when you guys were loading in, and I got to hang out with John Wesley, and my friend stayed back there, so they got to meet you, but I left. Dang it. And you've moved back to, you stayed in England, where a lot of folks seem to move to the U.S., but you stayed home, eh?
Yeah. Do a lot of people move to the States?
It seems like it. I was talking to Gary Green of Gentle Giant just before this, and he lives here. And so you're a Londoner?
Well, I was a Londoner for 62 years.
Mm-hmm. Oh, happy birthday, by the way. Happy birthday.
Thank you. And I'm 65 now. Mm-hmm. And 3 years ago, I moved out of London. That's it. So I'm outside.
Okay. Nice.
I'm enjoying. So
wonderful. I love this, and I really am thankful to talk to you, Richard. I won't keep you too much longer. People complain to me. They say, "Well, you should talk longer and longer." Well, the thing is, you know, I could talk all day, but at the same time, it's also this damn body saying I gotta go. But just thank you, number one, and a couple more questions. Studio work. How did you end up on this album? I mean, it's so out of it, just like, well, I can hear there's Richard, but it's like, what the hell is going on with this Japanese Hawaiian music or whatever?
how did you manage to find that?
While I was in Japan, to be honest with you.
Wow. That's one of those things you do in the past. Steve's on it as well, Steve Jansen. Where we were in Japan and we were getting asked to do a lot of different things.
Okay.
You kind of get swept up in it and it's this, well, as you know, it's a bizarre kind of album.
Very much so, yeah.
I mean, this guy's hero was Spike Milligan, and he's an English comic, and he liked to base a lot of his melodies on the Spike Milligan show, and it's bizarre.
Yeah.
I don't know what you mean. There's like Hawaiian stuff in there.
Yeah,
play these Hawaiian things on my Prophet.
wild.
It's probably one of the best overdubs I've ever done, but it's not a very good album.
I got it. Well, I have it. And then what about working with Joan Armour Trading? I saw you in a video with her.
Yeah, not me, but Steve and Mick.
Oh, okay. I thought I saw you in the video.
No.
Okay. No,
they worked with her, yeah. Yeah, amazing. Okay. She's still going strong. Amazing.
She's wonderful. Now yeah. that brings to mind how you work with Percy Jones on some of your stuff. And it just makes complete sense after you being with Mick Karn to work with another amazing bass player. I would imagine that you get a lot of respect from other musicians that maybe people wouldn't expect.
We do. But likewise, we respect so many musicians, and a lifetime isn't enough time to play with them all, unfortunately.
Yeah. But,
when we were young kids and we were listening to the early Eno albums, that was the first time Another Green World was the album that we heard Percy Jones.
Yeah.
We were just blown away.
Absolutely, yeah.
This is incredible. Phil Collins on drums as well.
Yes, yes.
Amazing rhythm section. And I hadn't heard Jaco Pastorius at that point. And I'd never heard anything so expressive with the bass, and it's kind of, I really got into it. And
yeah.
He was like a real hero. I thought he was amazing. Mm-hmm. And so when I got a chance to work with him, that was it.
No There's doubt.
A place, yeah. I mean, his style, it's incredible. He does whole kind of arrangements on the bass, and then I redo my things to kind of work around it. It's incredible.
Wow. That's awesome. That's awesome. So, Richard, that synthesizer behind you, is that kind of a rarity, that one? Yeah, yeah, right
yeah,
behind you.
Yeah, very rare. Yeah.
Modular, correct?
It's semi-modular. So it's hardwired on the inside, but also you can patch everything to kind of, well, basically get whatever sound you're after.
Is that an ARP?
No, it's a Roland
system. Oh, okay.
If you know the original System 700, which was kind of this thing that filled the wall.
Yes, yes.
This was called the Laboratory Series, and I think there's only about 49 of these made.
Mm-hmm.
It's from 1976.
Wow.
And it's super rare.
Yeah, that's definitely. And speaking of Roland, what an honor. It's like, I've actually used some of your signature patches that are available through Reason, And you've also done some other design work for Roland, is that right?
I have, yeah. I've done design work for them and Nord as well.
Oh, wow.
And as you say, Propeller Heads, Reason. Yeah, I mean, that was something I quite enjoyed. I mean, programming was the main thing for me growing up. So it's time consuming, but it's worth it.
Mm-hmm. No doubt. Richard, I'm really, really honored to have some time with you. And people always say they wish that I would talk longer, but I got to go. And it's like, I can do a pause and an edit, or we can end it. What would you prefer?
You can do a pause if you like.
Excuse me, 1 second.
You've got to respect the prostate. I think I'll come back in a second as well.
He had the Gucci album.
Right.
Thank you. Yeah. So yeah, that's the body. That's the body talking, huh?
I'm the same. I'm the same. I'm on medication for that kind of thing.
Yes, thankfully I'm not, but I figured we were close to the same age. I'm 67.
I'm 65.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, my
So,
wife says to, by the way, my wife says to me to give you her regards.
well, hello, because I do
Because
remember.
I think she was friends with you on MySpace before.
Fantastic. I didn't even have to bring it up. She remembers. I remembered, and I was blown away. This is Richard Barbieri's wife. Now she's also on at least one of these, right? She's Is she still making music?
She is at the moment,
Awesome. 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 And it's none of my business, but you guys have kids?
No.
Well, you've been too busy to raise any.
It was more a choice, but
Understood. Now, I would imagine, Richard, that you don't listen to much music. You make it, but do you listen to music these days?
yeah, I do. I don't listen to music when I'm making my own.
Okay.
But when I'm away from it all, I like to listen to lots of stuff.
Okay.
I'm in the process at the moment of buying all my favorite things on vinyl.
Yeah.
I got rid of my vinyl, as
Yeah.
a lot of people did,
Yeah.
probably in the early 80s,
Yeah,
which I
unfortunately, yeah.
always regretted. And and I miss it so much. So I every so often I'll just treat myself to a new vinyl edition, of
Absolutely.
my favorite things.
Absolutely. So it's like a lot of your music is really well suited for digital, and yet I would love to see this come out. This to me is just amazing. And I would love there's no vinyl edition of this, is there?
No,
Stores
there is.
across
Oh,
borders.
that's with Virgin. Again, it would have to be a thing of us licensing it from them and
Oh
then
boy.
going through this whole procedure.
Okay. So if that's not too much of a bummer to ask, Richard, because recently I incorporated myself so I could publish and own my own music. Is that an issue for you where you own a certain amount of music and some you don't?
Like you, we made that decision some time back, and so we own our own publishing. And any music we make now, we merely license it to people. If we want a major label, we just license it to them.
There
So
you
it always
go.
comes back to us. We're the owners,
Yeah.
and that's the way to do it. But of course, before that point, there's all the old school record labels and the
Right.
who own your music in perpetuity.
No doubt. So again, if it's too personal or too negative, just say, but throughout Japan and the pop thing, did you guys get paid right or did you get screwed?
Screwed.
Of course. Damn it. Damn it. Of course. Damn it. Now, are you still owed and do you get any royalties anymore?
Yeah, minimal
Minimal.
royalties.
Yeah.
Next to nothing, really.
That's frustrating. I'm really sorry to hear that.
Well, it's yeah. I mean, you just let go of that, really. I could earn more in a day now with Porcupine Tree than I could earn in 4 years with Japan
And that's something. That's amazing.
from past,
Yeah.
royalties.
That's just wild. Absolutely wild. So have you experienced through the music world things that you wanted to? Have there been things that opportunities that have come to you as a result of being in music that you're happy happened?
Of course, yeah, it's a mixture. It's a real mixture. And there are fantastic things like, for all their faults, in those days, the record company did loan you money, although you were going to have to pay them back, but at least it enabled you to do these things. So it enabled you to go off on a tour. It enabled you to go and record in these amazing studios. So, the moment you do that, you're in debt. And the bill is getting higher and higher. But at the same time, you're walking into the studio in the morning and Kate Bush is recording at the end of the corridor. Paul McCartney's at the other end on the left.
Awesome.
Tears for Fears are in the other one, and you're in the other one. And everybody is up in the canteen, all just having tea and sandwiches. And there's no one has bodyguards in those days. There's none of that crap. And you think, this is amazing.
Yes, it sounds magical.
And you're getting to actually work in these amazing studios. And so that's fantastic.
Yeah.
And then you go on tour and you play these iconic venues and you build up a fan base. And that's all wonderful.
Absolutely. Did you guys...
The dark side.
Yeah. Fucking dark side. Did you guys play the Soviet Union or Eastern Bloc countries?
We have played Moscow once with Porcupine Tree, not with Japan.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Japan
nice.
Japan didn't really tour much.
Okay. Now, speaking of Porcupine Tree, I get this impression, because I've watched recent interviews with you and Steven and Gavin and stuff, I get the impression that your relationship with Steven is like he's like a kind of a pesky little brother to you.
No, we get on very well. We get on really well when we're together.
Mm-hmm.
That's easy. He just does tend to annoy me in press.
I really enjoyed that.
It's just in the media.
Yes, I really enjoyed that, though, watching that exchange in your expression. It's like, what the fuck is he saying now?
Yeah. No, it's good, and probably the relationship's better now than it probably ever was. Mm-hmm. With Stephen and Gavin, and that this tour has helped to do that.
How about you and Stephen and David? Do you guys have any contact at all?
I'm in contact with Stephen all the time. We see each other quite a bit.
Nice.
David, no idea. I've no idea where he is or what he does really. The last time I saw him was on a Porcupine Tree tour, and we stopped by. We were playing in Boston, mm-hmm. and at the time I think he was in New Hampshire,
mm-hmm.
and we had a coffee. But that was, God, early 2000s.
Well, that's wild. Yeah, the latest thing I hear from him is his contribution to this Sakamoto tribute.
Okay.
Yeah, this just came out. It sounds like it's a recent vocal from David because his vibrato is really slow, like it sounds when you get older.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, speaking of that, you've never sang, you ain't going to sing for nobody? What's up?
No.
Come on.
It's best that way.
Come on.
What? I did notice for some reason, though, because I couldn't even pitch. I couldn't even explain to people what I was hearing. It was so bad. But when I gave up smoking
mm-hmm.
about 8 or 9 years ago, I suddenly could start pitching things and worked out kind of intervals, and it was much easier.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that's to do with, but...
Interesting.
No, I'm not going to say.
Okay. So I'm just going to bug you just a little bit longer, Rich. Thank you so much. This is wonderful to meet you and just talk to a little bit. This is just great. Really appreciate this. Any thoughts, feelings about this particular Porcupine Tree album? Just to put it into context, Signify is the first one that I thought was any good, to be honest. Okay.
Yeah, me too.
But then when I went back to this, I said, oh, okay. What are your thoughts about this one?
Well, it's that kind of mid-era Porcupine Tree phase that I would say was more pop, more concise. The songwriting was more about kind of getting across ideas within the context of a song over maybe four, 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a lighter feel, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Some people cite that as their favorite era of Porcupine Tree.
Mm.
I love it because, I mean, for me, pop music is the, that's the medium where you get real experimentation.
Mm-hmm.
In my view.
Yeah.
And that's the art. The art is trying to find these amazing arrangements and these amazing sort of sounds and that you can use within the context of a pop song. You know, we listen to like God Only Knows by the Beach Boys, and you think of the content in that. And that's only it's less than 2.5 minutes long.
Right.
I mean, you know, a lot of people's intros are 2.5 minutes.
It's incredible. It's an incredible achievement. It absolutely is. I agree about that. So that's the other thing that I kind of pick up on you, is that you are a true music lover. You're not just a workhorse, but you love music.
I do. And that's what drew me to your site and to kind of following you was that I could feel your love for music. And I would rather talk to people who love music than talk to music journalists.
I heard that.
But the best part,
kind
of have an agenda, you know. I enjoy it more. And we're not doing this to gain anything. We're not promoting anything. We're not.
No.
We're just chatting because we kind of we just connected on that level. You know?
Yes, this is so wonderful, and it's just it's a testament to the power of the art of the of music, the power of music. It's just fantastic. Just fantastic. And so I just want to say, I said it earlier, but on behalf of me and other music lovers and musicians, I just want to tell you, Richard, that I truly think that you are a giant in the music field. When I spoke to Gary Green last week, I told him that Gentle Giant is one of my favorite bands of all time. And your work, not Porcupine Tree, but Steve Jansen, Richard Barbieri is also in that. I want you to know that the Beatles, you've heard me say it, the Beatles changed my life. In my mind, in my experience, your work is on the same level as the Beatles, as how it has affected my life. Thank you so much, Richard.
Wow. Well, I'm honored. Thank you.
I just think that you and folks like you need an opportunity to hear this, you know, from the horse's mouth. I mean every word, brother. Some of the best, and you can see by this collection here, I'd be listening to all kinds of shit. You know what I'm saying?
I know.
And I keep up with, I can't remember the name of it, but there's a young metal band. I haven't bought the record, but I listened. I said they've been listening to Richard Barbieri because it's metal, but it's got that bubbly, airy thing going on underneath it. And that's the other thing. It's like, if you weren't there, no offense to Steven or anyone else, but that's the something that really makes Porcupine Tree special, is the way that you treat the sound. You take the music into a world with what you do, Richard. It's just fantastic.
Thank you. Thanks, Derek.
Well, I appreciate I'm just glad that, and also with these records that you've made, that you guys were willing to go out and make this music, regardless of whether it would make any money. You've made the world better. You made the world better.
We were struggling pretty bad during those times. Yeah.
I can imagine. So did you, you don't have to, but did you ever have to go back and get a job for a while?
No, managed to avoid that. But
well, cheers to that.
Yeah. Which I think just kind of shows that really we were only ever suited to making alternative music. Mm-hmm. That was our love and that was our strength.
Mm-hmm.
And we weren't really thinking of wanting to be famous, wanting to be pop stars, wanting to be commercially successful. We just wanted to make the music that we really felt, you know, we needed to do.
Yes.
It's at that point where a lot of people kind of say, this isn't working, we've got to go back and get a job.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah,
we rode it out, you know, and I think in a way that's why now I become more obsessed with kind of small amounts of money rather than big amounts of money.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, if somebody gave me a big amount of money, I kind of don't really react to it.
Yes.
Because I've been financially abused in the past. Gotcha. You know, it's like a dog where you give it love and it doesn't know how to accept it because it never had love. Whereas if there's like, I don't know, an outstanding check for £150, mm-hmm. I'll be obsessed with that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because that's what I used to have to get in order to pay for the heating.
Indeed. Indeed. You know? Yeah. And from an outsider's perspective,
psychologically,
no doubt. And from my perspective as an outsider, it appears that the more money, the weirder people get.
Yeah. Yeah. Probably so.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing with people with money is that money kind of comes to them.
Mm-hmm.
When you're desperate for money, when you really need it, you can't get it.
Yes. Yes.
You know, when we were trying to get just a few thousand pounds to make an album,
mm-hmm.
it was so hard. Mm-hmm. It was as if you were trying to prize this thing from somebody that, you know, and it was almost impossible. The moment that we said we don't really care about working with someone, they were throwing money at us.
That's wild. That's wild. That's wild. Well, speaking of working with someone, what was it like for you working with Ryuichi Sakamoto? He's one of my favorites of all time.
Well, I only really witnessed working with him when he came in and worked on the Japan material. But prior to that, he was recording in the same studios as us, and he was making that great album, B2 Unit.
Okay.
And that was recorded all with the Prophet 5. Mm-hmm. And so we would go into the studio because his producer was Steve Knight, who was our producer on Tin Drum.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd listen to watch him recording. And it was a real kind of masterclass in programming.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. That was very influential. Mm-hmm. And that kind of drew us towards the Prophet 5 because we just thought, wow, this is unbelievable. He's doing like bass drums, hi-hat, snares, chords, melodies, brass, everything.
Yeah, yeah. And what about Masami Tsuchiya? You worked with him. How was that?
Yes, well, Masami was the touring member of Japan on our last tour. And myself and Stephen worked on his own band, Ippudu.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
In Japan, which Percy Jones was part of as well.
Yes, I have that one, Rice Music.
Yeah.
And
he was interesting. He had interesting kind of ideas. I mean, I don't think he was suited to Japan group.
Yes.
It was too busy and too kind of flamboyant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
he probably wasn't the best choice thinking about it now, although I like a lot of other stuff that he's done.
Mm-hmm.
I think the right guy was the one we used before was David Rhodes.
Great guitarist, yeah.
Who was more about the sound and the parts and kind
yeah.
of, and then of course Rob Dean, who was our guitarist right through to Polaroids.
Right. Now, did you grow up with Rob Dean?
We didn't. No, he was the last one to join the band.
Okay.
And he was from a different area in London, so it was harder to socialize.
Okay.
We'd been at school together, and so he was from North London, we were from South London. But once the band got going, we were all a unit, and, you know, he was an important part of what we did.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm feeling like I want to kind of wrap this up, but it's like I don't want to keep you too long. Thank you so much for sharing this time with me.
No problem.
Was there any chance that this could have gone further? I think this is brilliant.
Yeah, I'm very proud of that.
Yes, my friend.
We're all proud of that.
Yes, my goodness, this is great. And it's not the band Japan. It's like the members of Japan. It's like, it's a whole nother world of music that you guys started here.
Yeah.
This is brilliant.
Yeah.
Any memories worth mentioning from the making of this?
Well, you know, it was fantastic. It was very enjoyable. We were all getting on really well. It was all improvised. So we got through a massive budget from Virgin Records with different studios and you know, going in without actually knowing what you're going to be doing is that is going to cost a lot of money.
Yeah, yeah.
But really enjoyable. It was just towards the end, you know, just as we veered towards that end point, then it started to change and it became something else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it became something that was a reminder of the past and I suppose all the same, you know, things came.
Yeah. yeah.
arose, and,
yes.
and it didn't end up great.
Yeah, I understand.
But you know, the work itself.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm very very proud of that. Yeah.
Yeah, glad y'all got that done. Glad you got it done. One more here. This 10-inch.
Yeah. Wow.
Breakable Moons. I'm also extremely proud of the fact that I'm also on this label along with you. They released a couple of my records. Were these scraps or Breakable Moons? What's the story of this piece here?
Well, they're kind of outtakes or tracks that didn't quite make the JBK album.
Okay.
Which was called Ism. And but you know, we still felt that they should be heard. They just couldn't find their place on the album. But sometimes you're looking for a home for these people in music. They're like orphans, and you want to find that foster home, or you want to find a place where it can belong.
Yeah.
And this company seemed to be doing nice little limited edition.
Yeah.
10-inch vinyl. You know, it was just seemed like a good format for it, and
it's great. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lovely sort of release.
Yeah. Now, do you collect your own stuff? Do you have your own collection of your work?
I do. I'm very,
I think that's important.
To have everything.
Yes, I think that's important. Yeah, so you have a copy of pretty much everything you've played on?
Yeah.
Because I can't even say that.
Yeah, I've got a copy of everything that I've been on.
That's beautiful. I heard you mentioned, like I said, I'm kind of getting to the end here, but I heard you mention Pawk Talk. Is that right? As someone you really like?
Who?
Pawk Talk.
No, I don't remember.
Laughing Stock. Okay, I got that mixed up.
Talk.
Yes, Talk. Yes.
Oh yeah, massive fan. Yeah.
Okay, it's the way I was saying the word. Sorry.
Yeah.
Because I hear some parallels in some of the Jansen Barbieri work. The space, as it were.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose the nearest we got to that as well was possibly the Rain Tree Crow album.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There's aspects of that which probably are influenced.
Now, that would have been an interesting pairing, Talk with either Japan or JBK on a show. That would have been interesting.
It would have been, yeah. Yeah, I mean, those three Talk albums, the later ones, are just unbelievable.
They are.
Amazing.
They are.
And we didn't even, you know, the Rain Tree Crow album doesn't get there to the same degree. We couldn't reach that. But yeah, I love it. I can't imagine it live somehow.
That would have been cool.
It would have been.
Richard, I want to thank you so much. I'm going to go ahead because my body is screaming again. I'm showing this again, folks. Pick up on this solo stuff. To my ears, a lot of this is superior to the Porcupine Tree. I'm not dissing. I say that because people listen to me and it's like, well, please listen to this. You know, you got the Porcupine Tree. Go a step further and check out what Richard's doing. Richard, I just love your music so much. And this has been a blast talking to you.
Thank you, Derek. You're very kind.
Enjoy the rest of your break. And you've never been to Nebraska to play, but have you been through Nebraska? Because this is where I'm at.
Is it? No. Where did we go that was nearest to you?
I saw you in Kansas City.
Okay.
And Kansas City is about 3.5 hours south of Omaha, Nebraska.
I wish we should have hooked up somehow on the tour, you know.
Would have been nice. Yeah. Of the four shows that I saw you, the most memorable was the one at a small club, a jazz club in Minneapolis.
Wow.
Yeah, and that was early on. That was maybe Dead Wing or maybe the tour before it, maybe.
Yeah.
But I also want to share that to me, Dead Wing and Fear of a Blank Planet, those two albums are just monster. Those are just monster albums.
Yep, Fear of the Blank Planet. That's up there for me. It's one of the best.
Thank you so much.
Well.
Thank you so much. Richard, thanks so much for spending time with me.
Cheers, Jerry. Thank you.
All righty. You take care. Have a good rest of the evening and talk to you again sometime, eh?
Yeah, you cured my cold. There, I didn't sneeze once.
All right. Take care now.
Take care. Bye-bye.